guess who's going to first?
Mark and Dave.
Okay. Just give them time to start in 1 minute, okay? And also then,
a warm good evening to all. I, Akshay S. Kumar, on behalf of Extramural Lectures team of IIT Madras, welcome you all to the inaugural lecture of EML series 2017-18. We have with us today prominent Indian experimental physicist, Dr. Harish Chandra Verma, who will speak on the topic, High School Physics, Where Are We Going Wrong? Dr. Harish Chandra Verma is an Indian experimental physicist and a retired professor at the Indian Institute of Technology, Kanpur. He has authored several books on physics at the graduate, undergraduate, and school levels. His most popular work is the two-volume books, Concepts of Physics. Has co-founded initiatives like Shiksha Sopan for the social upliftment of children from the economically weaker section living near the IIT Kanpur campus. We now request the respected sports advisor, Professor Santosh, to welcome the chief guest with a fruit basket. Thank you, sir. I now invite the speaker, Dr. H.C. Verma, to deliver his much anticipated talk on High School Physics, Where Are We Going Wrong? Please, sir.
Thank you all. So, they have given me this opportunity to address you all. So I must thank them, and I come to know that this is the first lecture in this series for this particular year, so it's an added honor to be here. And so many students are outside. Initially I thought that all the students have come out to see me entering. I really feel very sorry about them. I thought that we will ask the organizers to accommodate them in whatever empty space here it is. But there is no chance of doing that also. So it's okay. They have to be, I don't know, I am not able to face them. That is somewhat pinching me, but it's all right. One has to live with that. Okay, so coming to this particular topic, since we have all gone through the school education system, and therefore you know it much better than me, because we had, for us, school physics education is a kind of extra activity or a part-time thing that we do, but you have done it recently in these 3-4 years, and therefore you know the problems. And this particular problem, this particular topic was also suggested by the team that I speak on this topic only. So, okay, I'll give it a try. Now, first thing is, what is that, I'll do it from there only, huh? Otherwise, every time I have to look at that little thing. So first thing is that, what is the goal of education? There may be many, many things which are there, which can be so that aapko screen dikhai padega. Okay, let me introduce, he is my elder brother, Dr. Devi Prasad Verma. And he is 18 years older than me. Okay, and you know my age. The coordinator has already announced that. Okay, so you know my age plus 18. He is a mathematician. He was professor and head of mathematics department, Patna University. Okay, so the goal can be defined in many different ways, because there are many different aspects, and depends on what aspect you are thinking, there will be a goal of education. And I have picked up this one: to equip the person to live happily with the nature. But what is happening here is something very different, and that is to equip person live unhappily and ruining the nature. That's what our system is doing. And there are many things which can be talked about. This nature is extremely important for us. We are living on this planet Earth, and this is a so special place in the whole of the universe. We know we are in a very tiny corner of this galaxy, Milky Way, and in the Milky Way galaxy also, only in this small, tiny part called planet, there is life, there are emotions, there are wisdom, and all those things. And any indication of second place where there could be a life excites the community so much. Okay? So special we are. So special this planet is. And so special this nature is. And therefore, we have to live happily with the nature. But what we are doing in our system, we are ruining the nature. And that's a very, very serious issue. And education must target that. That the people who are educated, the people who go through the education system, they must realize this, that this prime thing that we conserve, we make our planet a place where this life can be sustained, can be retained, and it's not that it just becomes a history in the point. Okay. Now, in mathematics, we have a topic called sets. And there are varieties of sets which are introduced there, a null set, and union of set, intersection of set, and so on and so on. And one word is mutually exclusive set. So if you have to give the example of mutually exclusive set, one very good example is education and life. Okay, education and life, mutually exclusive set. I give you an example. There are many things which can be taken as symbol of national integrity. Whether you are in TN, Tamil Nadu, whether you are in Jammu Kashmir, whether you are in Mumbai or West Bengal, or a small town, big town, private school, or a government school, rural area, urban area. When children go to their first schooling, standard 1 or maybe KG, they are asked to draw a diagram showing a house. Okay? So everywhere this is taught, and this house looks like this, right? So I was sitting with a professor of biology, biosciences in IIT Kanpur, who happened to be chairman of our campus school, class 1 to 5. And in his chamber, there were several drawings, paintings were there on the walls, and he very proudly said that, look, our campus school children have made this, class children or KG children have made it. And most of them had this 2 vertical lines, 2 slant lines. Okay, 2 vertical lines, 2 slant. This is the house. It is a symbol of national integrity. No matter No matter where you are, no matter what kind of community you are working with, the schools, KG, nursery, class one, you can see these kind of houses on the walls of this. So I asked that the professor in charge of campus school, that in whole of the IIT Kanpur campus, in whole of the IIT Kanpur campus, we do not have houses with slant lines, we have houses like this. The child who is 3 years old, 4 years old, had never seen a house with those kinds of slanted lines, has only seen the houses with horizontal lines, flat planes. Okay, but education and life, mutually exclusive sets. When you are in education system, when you are in schools, house is defined in this way. When you go for living your life outside this education system, the house is defined like this. It's very, very difficult. There are many stories. We have a professor in material science, Sandeep Sangal. Okay, and his daughter, when she went to campus school in class one, very excited, she was going to school and all that, knew that professor of IIT Kanpur, all the time excited about the laptops and all those things, and all the time talking, so many people coming to house, everyone. So the little girl also was very excited for her first schooling. So in the very first week, she was given a lesson by the teacher, and that lesson, that particular lesson had the theme, who carries what? Like postman carries letters. So in that lesson, there were several examples of that kind, and after that, there were some questions. So after every chapter in the textbook, there are some questions written at the end. And the goal of teacher is to equip the student to solve those questions which are given at the end of the chapter. So after this lesson, that teacher gave homework to the children and asked to write answers of those four questions which were there at the end of the chapter. And this little girl named Bulbul, she came home very happily. First thing she did, opened that book and notebook and started reading the question and answering. And both the parents were sitting on the two sides looking into the notebook. Parents are very excited when the children do something. They say, okay, this is she is or he is the best child of the world and so on and so forth. So both of them are looking into it, what she is doing, what she will do now, and so that, and so on. There was a question. My father carries, and then empty space to be filled in. Bulbul took some 10, 12 seconds to think what to write, and then she wrote L, A, P, T, O, T. That is what she has seen all the time. The IIT professors will not be seen without laptop. My laptop is in this bag. And the parents were very happy. And Dr. Sangal and his wife Rita Singh were very happy. Okay, very intelligent answer. But what happens next day? Next day she goes to school and the teacher asks, remember, there are, it's a 30 minutes period, okay? It's a 30 minutes period and there are 40 children sitting, right? So both nines are here. It is 30 minutes period, 40 children sitting, each child has to, must have written ideally four answers, four questions. So a total of some 160 questions, answers are there for those 30 minutes, and not for those 30 minutes because she has to go to the other lesson also, next lesson also. So what the teacher will do? She gave a collective address. How many of you have done all the four questions? So there were some hands, raise your hands, some hands were raised, and then she gave a pat on the back. Oh, that's very nice, and you should continue like this and that, and blah, 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 blah. Then how many of you have done one question only, and so on. So in 5, 10 minutes, 7 minutes, she wrapped up the thing and said, for those who have not done, let me write the answers. And then she wrote answers on the board, and for that particular question, she wrote, my father carries umbrella. Very natural. It's very natural. A school, primary school teacher's father can only carry umbrella. All right. Now comes the serious message. Now comes the serious message. This 5-year-old bulbul, she looks at the board, opens the drawing box, takes out the eraser, erases laptop from the notebook and writes their umbrella. Write their umbrella. Laptop is wrong in the school. Laptop is right in, correct in the house. Outside the school it is laptop. Inside the school it is umbrella. So that's the kind of mutually exclusive set we are working with. So these are the problems of school education, which persist for quite some time. So, now, experiments. People say that experiments are to be focused. People should do in science, they should do experiments and all that. But what kind of experiments? I did my high school sometimes in 1967. And I did this experiment, okay? And the people who are in high school, 2017, they are also doing this experiment. In half the century, 50, 60 years, the world has advanced. India has so much of progress, but our school education is still stuck with find the value of G. Why should I? Why should I find the G? I know the value of G. I know the value of G. Why should I find the G? But everyone in India, everyone in high school in India will be asked to find the value of G. Okay, so these are the kind of so-called experiments to connect science with reality and all those experiments. So that is also of these kinds. So no point doing these kind of things. Then the other problem where we are going wrong with our school education, especially in upper primary and high school, those formative years, our central theme is how to answer questions. The whole education system, the teachers are telling, the tutors are telling, the coaching institutes are telling how to answer questions. This is the kind of question, this is the kind of answer it should be. If this is the kind of question, this is the kind of answer it should be. Books, help books with titles, 5,000 questions solved. They are sold like hotcakes. Oh, 5,000. So people write to me, sir, where can I find solutions of your concepts of physics problems? They are very difficult. So where are the solutions? So the entire focus is finding answers to the question, how the knowledge will advance. How the knowledge will advance, how the science will go up. So this this answering question is something which should not be at the center. What it should be, how to ask questions. How to ask questions. If new questions are originating in minds, If new questions are originating in minds, then only the knowledge will be advanced. If the same questions which had been written in textbooks, which are there in market, which are there in the system, if those same questions are answered in our system, in our schools, in our institutions, then the knowledge is not going to advance, but the world will advance. And the school system is not preparing, not empowering the student to face the world, or to live in the world, or to contribute in the betterment of the world. So the central theme should be how to ask questions. Yesterday I was in Pondicherry, and yesterday I was giving a camp, a training, so-called training to school teachers. Okay? Now, in chemistry book, there are science teachers. In upper primary, you don't have physics and chemistry separate. So there are science teachers. So in the chemistry chapter, they know that there is an atom, and then there are electrons which are going around the nucleus. The nucleus has certain protons and certain neutrons. Helium is the second in periodic table. They know everything. Whatever is written in textbook, they know. So in the chemistry chapter, it's written about alpha particle, that gold. Which experiment? Rutherford's gold foil experiment with alpha particles. Rutherford did not do the experiment, by the way. It's called Rutherford's experiment. But Rutherford never did that experiment. That experiment was reported in a philosophical magazine, 1909. You can Google search and find that original paper. The experiment was done by two persons. One was Geiger and one was Marsden. But anyway, fine. It was in the Rutherford's laboratory. Rutherford was in charge of the laboratory. So it is called... It is popularly known as Rutherford's experiment, and it's popularly known as Rutherford's gold foil experiment. If you look at that article which Geiger and Marsden had published in Philosophical Magazine, they used 9 different metals in that experiment, including copper and aluminium and all whatnot. But popularly, people have picked up gold only because gold is precious, because gold is prestigious, so it's called gold foil experiment. So whatever. So that alpha particle is there in their chemistry book, and they know very well. When I ask, they know very well there are 2 protons and 2 neutrons in alpha particle. Then there is another chapter on energy. So energy produced in sun is 3-4 chapters apart. There they say that in the core of the sun, hydrogen is being converted into helium and the energy is produced. They knew it very well. They knew it very well. Now, the question I asked was, a helium nucleus has 2 protons and 2 neutrons. And hydrogen has only protons. So, if 4 hydrogen nuclei somehow conspire to make a helium nucleus, there are 4 protons, where are those neutrons coming from? There are no neutrons to start with. Your hydrogen is only proton, 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 proton. Electrons are detached at that high temperature, but anyway, they are there in the vicinity at least. But there are no neutrons. Okay? So when it makes helium, and helium nucleus must have 2 protons and 2 neutrons. If there are 4 protons, it will become beryllium. Of course, the nucleus will not be stable. But with 4 protons, it is beryllium. It's not helium. Now, these teachers were all shocked. Okay? Now, my worry is, why this question did not occur to any of the teachers? This question should have occurred, right? This question should have occurred. If you order idli and you don't get sambar, you immediately question, where is my sambar? But here no one is worried. No one is worried. You can create neutrons, and if it is not there, no matter how it comes. So in one chapter, they are very particular. There has to be two neutrons there and two protons there. Another chapter, they say that hydrogen is converting to helium. But then no connection between these chapters, because connections, relations are made in real life. And education is not real life. Okay? So no need of making relations between two different chapters, which are four chapters apart from each other, or 20 pages apart from each other. Okay? No one is worried about that. Questions must appear in mind. Questions appear, and the fertile ground for these new questions coming up are younger people, are students. Teachers somehow have lost that capability of questioning, questions germinating in mind. Students have that. And teachers or our education system, high school, intermediate, upper primary education system, that puts a lot of chemical manure into the mind, which kills all those fertile things, and you also gradually lose the capability of asking new questions. New questions are not coming up. In any college you see, first year students and fourth year students. How many questions the first year students ask, and how many questions the fourth year students ask? Right? In schools, colleges, degree colleges, institutions, engineering colleges, as more and more you are in system, more and more those thinking cells become dormant. Okay? When I was in Patna Science College, first year, there the geography is, physics department is here, it's a degree college, physics department is here, chemistry is there, and English is, literature is there, and so on. Different things. So the students have to change buildings. After every period, they have to change buildings. And 5 minutes time is given for that only. 9 to 9:55 will be period, and then 10 to 10:55 will be period. 5 minutes are given. When first year students are admitted, on the roads connecting these buildings, every hour, it's a periodic motion, periodic phenomena. Every hour, you will see students running from one building to other building. Every hour, every after, every 1 hour, students, a whole crowd of students running on those roads to go to that new building, sit there on the front bench, and so on. 1 month later, that running is converted into brisk walking. Another 2 months, that brisk walking becomes slow strolling, just strolling. And after 6 months, you don't see any movement. Hardly you see any movement. More you are in the education system, more you are indifferent to questions, no new questions. So that's a big thing where we are going wrong. And teachers always shy away. If there are new questions, I will not be knowing the answer, then what I will do? Huh? So in my camps, in my workshop, I make it a point that at least once in a day, 3-4 hours of, after 3-4 hours of interaction, at least once I have to say that, oh, I do not know this. Okay, now the teacher says, oh, H.C. Verma does not know this. And then I will act as if I am trying to work out the answer. And then yes, it is like this. So that teachers also don't feel shy in saying that I do not know. Okay, it's a big hurdle. Now, school colleges are called temples of learning. It is a very nice analogy. This is a very nice, that word temple and learning is very nice analogy. Okay, so school colleges are temples of learning. We have temples for temples of gods also. right? So we have hundreds of thousands of temples of God in India. We have hundreds of thousands of temples of learning in India, right? Now, all of these hundreds of thousands of temples of God, there are only few, right? There are only few which you can count on fingers where there is an spiritual enlightenment. You go there and you feel some energy is coming in. You go there, you feel that your sorrows are melting down. You go there and you feel a divine peace of mind. But how many of them are there? How many of them are there? Very, very few, right? You can count on fingers. Rest of the temples, it becomes a ritual only, okay? A ritual only. You have to do this kind of aarti, and you have to put the flowers at this place, and you have to light that incense stick at this place, and you have to do 4 times or 7 times go round that building, parikrama, all those things. So it becomes a ritual. A person visits that place, comes out, okay, some small temporary short lifetime changes are there for few minutes or few hours or maybe a day or so, and after that it again becomes the same. So vast majority of our temples of God are doing these rituals, some chanting of some mantras, and without knowing the meaning and without experiencing that. We have hundreds of thousands of temples of learning in India. There are only few, like the place you are sitting in. There are only few where you have some educational enlightenment, where you learn new things. When you learn to create new things, not only you learn new things. You learn new things, that is fine, that's new for you, but it was not you new for your professor. Okay? But you learn to create new things. That's the game. You learn to create new things, which is new for your professors also. There are only few such temples of learning where you have this enlightenment of education. And the vast majority of these schools, colleges, institutions, which we call temples of learning, we do rituals only, the chanting of mantras only. Om Bhur Bhuvah Svah Tat Savitur Varenyam, half mb square plus mgh plus rho, half rho, okay. A whole list of mantras are given. This is called Bernoulli's mantra. You have all kinds of Ganesha Stuti and Saraswati Vandana and Vishnu Strot. So you have all kinds of mantras, Bernoulli's and Faraday's and Einstein and Bose and this and that. Varieties of mantras are there, and you are supposed to chant all those things again and again, again and again, till the examination is over. Till the examination is over. So to come out, the education system has to come out from that. The rituals are to be converted into actual enlightenment, and that is how the system will be effective. Okay? The whole process of our school system is very, very unnatural. When is your period for a physics course? What time to what time? Morning 8 to 9?
No.
Then?
When it is
normally?
8 to 1 p.m.
Huh. Physics course. In this semester, physics course. Do you have a physics course? Okay. What time it is? 8 to 9, 9 to 10, 10 to 11?
8 to 9,
10
to 11.
10 to 11 is the physics course, fixed boundary condition. You cannot learn physics beyond that. There is a particular lecture hall in which the physics will be learned. In no other hall you can learn physics. And sometimes in school system, children are assigned seats. Roll number 1 will sit here, roll number 2 will sit here, roll number 17 will sit here. When Lord Buddha sat under that particular tree in Bodh Gaya, then only things entered the mind. So these chairs are like those special trees. Only when you sit there, you will get all those things, otherwise you will not. Very, very fixed boundary conditions. But that is not the natural process of learning. The natural process is when it comes naturally, the same classroom and the same teacher. Okay? Right? So what is the natural process of learning? This is a natural process of learning. In the first 3 years, 0 to 3 years, how much a child learns? Just think of it. We have all gone through that 0 to 3 years period. Now we do not have memories of that. How did we learn the language that was spoken in our family? In 0 to 3 years, every child learns one full language, whatever language is spoken in the family. Was there a teacher appointed for that language? Was there a course developed for learning that language? In the 0 to 6 months, the child must learn 10 names of 10 fruits and 5 flowers. And next 3 months term or semester, the child should learn this much of grammar or punctuations. Was there a course designed? Was there a place assigned that sit here and learn that language? Was there an examination? After every 6 months, there will be an examination of the child. So in 3 years, there will be 6 examinations. And if you fail in the examination, the whole course has to be repeated from the beginning. Nothing of that sort was done. Nothing of that sort was done. And still, every child learns one full language, and to make the child learn the second language, teachers struggle for years and years and years and years. Lot of mathematics, lot of face recognition, lot of social behavior, how to, a child always never confuses and who is mom, who is aunt. Or who is mom, who is father. Everyone has two ears and two eyes and one nose and a few hairs and all these things. How come the child learned it that this is female and this is male and this is mom and this is father? How come? How did the child learn that? That's the natural process of learning. The parents, the siblings, the grandfather, the grandmother, the neighbors, the flowers, the air, the water which is flowing through the tap, all these things are teaching the child. That's the natural process of learning. The child is learning from the environment. The child is learning from the life. Life and education are absolutely intermingled. There's no distinction between life and education. The education is coming from the life itself. Every object in the vicinity is teaching the child, and the child comes up with so much of great knowledge in this 0 to 3 years. And after that, 3 years onward, you put them in fixed boundary conditions. The learning has to go through the teacher only. And what you have to learn, the one which CBSE has prescribed in the NC. There was absolutely no course designed for 0 to 3 years. You want to learn geography? Fine. You see the sunrise, you see the sunset, you see the river flowing, and you see the terrain, and you learn geography. If you want to learn biosciences, fine, mathematics, fine, language, fine. There was nothing imposed. But here, what is written in NCERT, only that has to be taught. And that has to go through the teacher only. Then only you can do that. These are the kinds of problems that we have. Okay, so I have learned some lessons very hard way during this 38 years of my interaction with students. One is science learning must be in tune with the lifestyle that you are living. You talked about concepts of physics. There is nothing very special about concepts of physics as far as physics is concerned. Resnick Halliday book is an excellent textbook for physics. There was no need to bring in any other book at that level. Okay? The only problem was I tried to use this Resnick Halliday as a textbook, as the main textbook for my class 11, 12 teaching at Patna Science College. And 3-4 years I failed. First, I doubted my own capability of delivery. But then in 3-4 years, I learned that no, in school system, where the children are not that mature, the science cannot be told in isolation with lifestyle. The kind of life our children are living, the kind of environment you are in, the science has to be packaged in that. And that is what I tried to do in concepts of physics, and it was welcomed by the community. Okay, that is how this concepts of physics came. And experiments should be integral part of science teaching, but then it should be experiment. You know, when you fell ill and you go to a doctor, doctor gives medicine. And 2 days pass, you take the medicine and nothing good comes out. Then you go to the doctor again. And the doctor says, okay, this medicine did not work. Okay, fine, take this medicine. And then this medicine and this medicine. Then your comment is, the doctor knows nothing. He's only experimenting on me. That is the meaning of experiment. That is the meaning of experiment. Experiment means I do not know the result. I have to experiment and see what it is. Okay? But in our experiments in school system, all results are known. Okay? So experiments in that true sense, must be an integral part of science teaching, where experiments are done, where we do not know the result. Even the teacher does not know the result. The teachers, the students, the administration, the management, they have to make a team. The learning is because of that team. A child learns so much in 0 to 3 years because all the educators make a team. Parents, father, mother, grandmother, sister, sibling, neighbor, nature. Everyone makes a team to teach the child. Here also, it has to be a teamwork, and then such experiments should be brought in and put together in our system, and that is what we are trying to do right now. That is my agenda, is even parallel to the IIT Kanpur mandate. I had been doing that, these experiments, designing experiments and doing this teachers camps and so on and so forth. There are hundreds of such pictures. This is the picture from Karaikal. Okay, near Pondicherry you have Karaikal, and this is school physics teacher. When we were talking of magnets and electromagnets, and I told that if it is a magnet, there should be magnetic field lines. So can we see the magnetic field lines at least qualitatively? So the current was passed in that, and then a lot of pins were there, and I can just dip and see what happens. And all the teachers did this. And some of the teachers who got this kind of line, they were having that divine enlightenment. There was a permanent peace of mind. Ah, darshanam. They had darshanam. They could see that magnetic field lines. So this is the kind of things we are doing, sitting on the floor, sitting on the floor, working together, doing some new experiment, designing some things. So these are the kind of things which I am in and trying to, at my own personal level, trying to make amendments in this school system where we are going wrong. This is from Jammu Kashmir, and the day these people are doing experiments here, on that particular day, the temperature in Srinagar was -7 degrees during day hours. Outside there was snowfall, a lot of snow was there, and inside we were doing all these experiments and all those things. This particular person on the top left with a funnel as a cap, he's a joint director of education department, joint director. He was there during all our camps, and when he saw that people are so happy wearing this cap, looking into the mirror, as where is yellow, where is, so he came to me, can I also do that? Most welcome, please do. So he's the joint director. So we are trying to change these temples of learning into actual educational enlightenment centers. That is what I do. Questions must arise. Deeper analysis should be done. Self-thinking. Don't ask for solutions. Don't ask for tutors, helpers. The professors are there. That's the legitimate person who will from whom you can take help. All right. But that is also, remember, that is also an assistance. The actual learning comes from self-thinking. So those cells are to be activated. So that self-thinking part has to be done. And your goal should be high. Getting admission into IIT system or getting a good grade card is not high goal. Remember, grade cards have a small half-life. During my school days, my grade cards always had three red lines under marks. There are two columns, subject and marks. And in the marks column, the marks are entered, and then some red lines are put there if the marks is less than the F grade, D grade boundary cutoff, which in school system it is 30%. Okay. In my school, grade cards almost always in all annual examinations had three red marks. That means in three of the subjects, my marks was less than 30%. In my school, there was a rule or norm or clause that if a student fails in three or less number of subjects, he or she will be promoted to the next class and will not be asked to repeat the course. And I made full advantage of that law. And when I was at IIT Kanpur, Professor Mani was my teacher there, my professor there, he taught me quantum mechanics too. The grade card is 9.9 by 10. I just missed 10 by 10. So what? So what? Did Hare Krishna know that? Did your EML coordinator know that I had 9.9 by 10? Or did you know that in my schools it was less than 30%, 30%, 30%, three times? How does it matter now? How does it matter now? All these great cards, good or bad, they have small half-life. They are very small half-life. Everywhere I attend meetings, NCRT chairman, commissioner, they call it commissioner, will give report to HRD minister that in our KVS, Kendriya Vidyalaya Sangathan, 95% of the students have passed the examination, 80% of students have gotten more than 90% or more than 70%, this, that, the entire evaluation of school, of educational system is based on how many students are scoring how many marks. And therefore, the whole focus of administration, management, be it private school, be it government school, be it Kendri Vidyalaya Sangathan, Navodaya, whole thing is on marks. Our students should get good marks. But remember, that has a short half-life. The long half-life is how much skill you have acquired, how much thinking power you have acquired. Can you think new things? Can you think new things? Can you do innovation? If that can, that you have learned, if the education system can do this, then you have empowered the student to live in the world happily and make the world better place than what it is now. Okay, so that's the kind of goals to be set in. That's the kind of goals to be set in. I will just stop here with this last slide. I have several slides, but I have taken 55 minutes. In our system, who thinks? Who thinks? The students can think, but they are trained not to think. Okay? The teachers do not think because the textbook is very nicely written. They don't need to think. Then, authors. No. Authors, no. Huge majority of our textbooks, the authors do not think on it. Even now, many of the textbooks say that you burn a candle in a saucer plate, put water in it, and then put this inverted tumbler there, and oxygen is consumed, and water goes up. And 21% of water will go up because there is 21% of oxygen. These kind of writings in textbooks are prevailing for at least 50 years, I have seen. And I don't know from when it is coming. Yesterday, I did this experiment in Pondicherry. And I showed them it was hardly 10% rise. Then I asked the teachers to write in their final feedback that this hall of Sarvashiksha Abhiyan is not good for teachers' training because it contains only 10% of oxygen. Textbook authors, no thinking. Whatever is going on, they are repeating. Then who is thinking? Paper setter. Barring those small number of temples of learning where actual educational enlightenment is there, one of which you are sitting in. Okay, barring that, when I was in BSc, I wanted to do all possible questions which can be asked in BSc honors. So I collected all varieties of question papers for last 30 years in Patna University. And in each paper, I could hardly come out with 20 different questions. 8 questions were set for examinations. Out of those 20 only, 8 are set in 1971, 1972, 1973. That union, that superset is just 20. If paper setters think, how come 30-year questions, the union of that is only 20 questions, and every year 8 questions are set in the paper. Okay, board, syllabus, committee, director, HRM, human resource minister, who is thinking? And most importantly, if the students are not thinking or not made to think, and teachers are not thinking, then it doesn't matter who is thinking. It doesn't matter who is thinking. If my teacher is not thinking, if my students are not allowed to think, then no matter who is thinking or who is not thinking, it doesn't matter, that system will still remain the same. So this is the last point I would like to make, and I'll just stop here abruptly. Escape. Stop. Stop it. Okay. All right, thank you. Thank you very much. Thank you.
Okay.
Thank you, sir, for that inspirational and insightful talk. The floor is now open for questions.
I will repeat.
So my question is that now that you have retired, do you plan on updating the books? And who will keep updating this book? Because, for example, in the gravitational chapter, there is this, at the end, you have said that the formula won't remain the same. There is some new theories that suggest that there is exponential formula for the gravitational. So how do you plan on updating the books?
Okay. So there are two parts of the question. One is, now that I have retired, don't use this because this school education system and all this work with teachers, etc., is going on, and I have full engagement in. I'm not retired as such. Okay. Now apart from that, yes, the updation is always required. Updation is when I was writing this book in 1980s. That time there were some people who had this suggestion that gravitation formula can be different at different places, but now that did not work out. In these 25 years that have passed after this book was published, that has not worked out. So in the new version, that will be dropped. Okay. Now whether I'm planning to do the updation, yes, I'm planning, and I'm working on it for last 3 years, and that updation will come in Hindi. Amen. and the name of book was suggested by students only. I wrote on my Facebook page, which is H.C. Verma Physics, that I am planning to write such and such a book in Hindi, and it will be an updated version of concepts of physics. Suggest name of the book, and several suggestions came, and from there I have picked Bhautiki Ki Samaj. So that will be the name of the book.
You
give them, it will go.
Sir, what is your view about the JEE preparation scenario in India?
Actually, there's a related question. Preparation is one thing. There's a related question. The JEE system, evaluation system itself, not the preparation. The people who conduct JEE, the people who set question papers. So there itself, a lot of thinking is required. And some of us, including our professor Markandalu here, we are not happy with the kind of system that we are doing, the kind of JEE evaluation that we are doing. Suddenly, we are not very happy about it. But then the numbers are so large, right? Some 300 or 400,000 students, that we are not able to come out with a good evaluation system. And there is a sentence in quantum mechanics, one of the central sentences, that measurement disturbs the system. So any kind of examination system will surely have will disturb the whole thing, and therefore one has to come out very a lot of thinking has to go in where this disturbance is minimum according to the allowed Heisenberg uncertainty principle. So we have some kind of Gaussian wave packet where it's minimum, but our system, JEE system, is actually not doing well. The kind of uncertainties which are there in the final evaluation is very large, and it has to be brought down. So that is one part. And then the preparation part, if you are to advise your younger brothers and your younger sisters, the thing to be, the message to be given is once again that getting into IIT system should not be the goal. Every year so many thousands of students are getting in, so what is the big deal about it? You have to do something which nobody has done till yet. That should be the goal. Getting into IIT system is not a big deal. Every year some 6,000-7,000 students are making it. So you tell your juniors that your potentials are not for this tiny thing of getting into IIT system. Your potential is to create a new world out of it. Okay. And therefore acquire skills. Acquire skills. Don't look at what kind of questions are in JE and this kind of question I should attempt this way or that way. You acquire skills, mathematical skills, physical skills, observation skills, thinking something new, coming out with something new. If that is there, getting into IIT system will be a byproduct. If you get it, fine. If you don't get it, you don't worry about it. You have gotten the main thing. Right? So if there is 10% extra on whatever Brook Bond tea you are purchasing, even if that 10% is not there, you are happy purchasing the Brook Bond tea. Okay? Main bulk is that skill. Your main bulk is that training of mind. Your main bulk is your capability of doing new things. That has to be acquired during that preparation period. That preparation period is very important, very fruitful if you can utilize that, because the intense studies you are making, that time if you can acquire those skills, nothing like that. No matter whether you are in IIT system or you are outside IIT system, if you have that skill, your career will be definitely, not only your career will be very good, you will be a useful person for the nature, for the environment, for the planet Earth. So that's the message to be given. Yeah, you tell the question, I'll repeat.
Sir, what is the driving force for you for all the work that you are doing now? What is the
driving force for me for all the work that I am doing now? One thing that I have gone through this educational system, both sides, from 3 red lines to 9.9. So I know the system very well. And therefore, that drives me that I was fortunate that finally I came on the track. Otherwise, I would have been thrown by the system, okay? But not everyone is that fortunate. The system must be throwing many, many potentially capable persons out of this, branding them, putting stamp that failed, okay? Did not qualify, defective piece, those kinds of brands. So that's one driving force where I want everyone, I tell you, just sit down. I tell you a story. There is this very recent story, last semester only. There was a girl called Kalpana in IIT Kanpur who was admitted in B.Tech bioscience program. First, she was admitted in mechanical engineering. Then after one semester or two semesters, when she did not do well in examination, people said that biosciences will be easier options to switch. So she switched. 2011 or 2010, yeah, 2010. She was a 2010 admitted. And 2017, 15 days, exactly 15 days before the final end semester examination, she came to my office. She walked in. And then she introduced herself that I am Kalpana and I have 2010 batch and I have not yet completed the course. And I failed the physics course 5 times, and the 6th time I am appearing. I failed in many other courses also, but somehow in these 7 years, I could clear that backlog. But this backlog is still hanging. And this is the seventh year in IIT Kanpur, and I'm not able to do that. So I asked, OK, what was your performance in the mid-semester examination and the quizzes? And came to know that in mid-semester examination and quizzes, total 110 marks paper, she got zero in 110 marks examination. OK? But she came to me 2 weeks before the end semester examination. So I said, how come you came to me at this critical time? I had never interacted her before. Then he says that some employee in the Doha office told me to go to HC Verma. Okay? So I was so satisfied that not only among the students, among the employees also, I have a reputation. Employees also, I have a reputation. Such a gone case is being referred to Dr. H.C. Verma. So I said, OK, I will work with you. I worked with her. And during the first and second interaction only, I gazed that she was not a duffer. She was not a duffer. She was able to argue. She was able to raise questions from DJ, this Griffiths, electromagnetism. Nice question, intelligent question. And that further motivated me to work with her. In 2 weeks, I gave her perhaps 5 or 6 sessions, each session of 2 hours. And the girl passed that examination of physics 103. And when I saw her photograph in that convocation dress and holding the degree of me, and her mother was in tears. She talked to me over phone that day, and she was in great tears that what a person you are. So these things drive me. I know that our students, whose our system rejects, many of them have potential. Okay, and I want to save them. So that gives the driving. And of course, when I talk to teachers, like our Jammu Kashmir teachers, our Pondicherry teachers, and everywhere where I go, when I talk to teachers, and I give sessions, I see the transformation in the teachers. That drives me. When I talk to students, I see the transformation in students. That drives me. Right? So nothing succeeds like success. Okay.
Sir, thank you for this session. My name is Anand. I came with Dr. Mani. I teach in a school. I've been teaching in a school for about 10 years now. I have a very straight question. I'm teaching physics in 11 and 12. And incidentally, I'll be telling my students that I just came for your lecture because they are following H.C. Verma in class 11 and 12. So they'll be very thrilled. My question is very straightforward. What is your, I know it's a very general, broad question. What would be your advice to a physics teacher who teaches in, say, class 11 and 12 or 9 and 10 for that matter? What advice would you want to give a teacher how to go about, given the fact that we are in this framework of, you know, syllabus and so on and so forth?
So you have to go by those boundary conditions which are put by the system. There's no compromise on that. You have to give results. Those 90% and 95% and 99%, you have to give that result. That your management will ask for that. So that has to be done. And the students should also have a decent grade card at the end. Right? No one can say that grade cards are not very important, but therefore don't worry. Even if you have to ensure that your students get a good grade card. My advice would be, ask yourself after every month, let's say last day of the month, 30th or 31st or 20th or 29th, ask yourself, in this 1 month, what new did I do? Did I formulate a new demonstration experiments for teaching Faraday's law, electromagnetic induction, or work energy theorem, or this or that? Did I formulate a new numerical problem which focused on a particular aspect? Did I prepare a good question paper for my class test? Ask yourself, what new did I do in this 1 month? Something has to be done. Otherwise, your own thinking cells will become dormant. Because same syllabus every time. That has to be done. Now, coming back to that time frame, you have to have your pre-test by November and this by this and this by that. You spend 90 to 95% of time in the traditional teaching, finishing your syllabus, preparing the students for examination, and all that, 90 to 95%. But 5 to 10%, so that means you squeeze your whole thing by, say, 5%, right? And then you create some space. And in that space, you take one single concept, Fleming left-hand rule, okay? Or force on a current-carrying wire when it is in magnetic field. Pick up one topic, one single topic. Normally, in the traditional framework, you should have finished in 10 minutes. Spend 50 minutes on that, 100 minutes on that. And you have to find those 100 minutes in the whole of this thing. You squeeze very little of it, okay? So if you can just keep that candle burning, that innovations, the deep understanding, the questioning, the analysis, the observation, all those scientific temper, right? So all those things you try for those 50 minutes, those 100 minutes, those 150 minutes in the whole of this 3 month semester term. So, but for that, you have to prepare yourself very well. For that 50 minutes, you may have to spend 500 minutes because there's something new that you are doing, but you do that. Okay, so traditional finishing the syllabus, preparing the students for examination, ensuring that the student gets good grade, you continue with that. And then make some space. Just everything, this much of thing, if you compress 5%, then the thing which is available for one single concept is huge. So you won't have any crisis. But then you come out with your innovative ideas, what I will do in that. I have no problem.
This will be the last question the speaker will be taking.
It depends who gets the mic.
I have the mic, so I think I'll use it. So the mic is here, sir.
Okay.
So you talked about learning environment, and you said that for a baby, the entire household and the neighbors and life is contributes to learning. Now, when teachers like us, when we teach, we are getting people at a much later stage. So if you see, the child at that age has a much larger initiative and it's much more curious naturally. So the effort the others have to do is really the kind of guidance you have to give to a bright and original thinker. That's the kind of environment you face with a baby. But that is not the thing later. So what do you have to say about that? A teacher has to make a lot of effort to arouse the curiosity in a student at a later stage. But for a baby, it is not necessary because the natural curiosity
correct.
Is there.
Correct.
So what do you have to say about that?
Very true. Very true. But there is another angle to it. There's another angle to it. For that newborn baby, the things are all natural, simple, the baby is happy, okay, and learning things. But the person who has undergone this torturous education system for some 12, 13 years, 14 years, is thirsty. Okay, he's very thirsty. He's striving. One drop of water will be like something very, very important for this boy or girl, right? For a natural learner of age 2 years, that's not the case. That's not the case. But if my stomach is full, fine. I get some sweets here, some chutney here, some idli here, and all of those things. Good, fine. So if you give me a better sweet, I said, okay, fine, thank you very much. That's it. But if I am hungry for 10 days, 15 days, 1 month, I have not gotten anything to eat, and then you give me a dry bread without butter. Oh, so you are in an advantageous position. You are in an advantageous position. The people who have come to you have gone through 13, 14 years of that dry era. And now you are here with a simple bottle of water. Oh, they will welcome you. But have that bottle of water with you. Have that bottle of water with you. Don't make them strive even after coming to your class. But for that, you have to work very hard. All my family members were surprised. For every lecture in IIT Kanpur, even after teaching the same course so many times, why I am taking 4 to 5 hours of average preparation time? They were all surprised that you know everything, you have written books, you are so popular because of your physics knowledge and physics delivery. Why you need 5 hours for 1 hour of lecture? Even after teaching 20 years, 25 years in IIT Kanpur? No, you have to put in a lot of effort for that. But you are in advantageous position. They have never seen it. When I go to class and do a demonstration experiments which has some surprise element. Okay? I was teaching gravitation or something in my BTech course, and I just put a pendulum here, simple pendulum here. Took a clamp stand and then tied the string on that clamp. And suspended something and oscillated. Okay, so this was the kind of stage, and I oscillated it this way. And then I started talking other things. I wrote some formula, some equation on the board. And after 2 minutes, I asked, "Did I oscillate it this way?" And all the students were shocked. "No, no, sir, you oscillated it this way. But I did not go there. I was on this side. Who did it? Who disturbed my pendulum?" "No one disturbed. So, but from east to west, it became north. In 3-4 minutes only. No Foucault pendulum. No Foucault pendulum. In 3-4 minutes only, 5 minutes only, it changed its plane by 5 minutes. And the trick was at the knot. How that string was tied on that clamp, there was the trick. So in a particular fashion, if you tie it, then the torques, etc., from that knot when it oscillates, that changes the plane. But then, to come to this this thing, that I can do this, I took maybe 10 hours of experimentation. Okay? But then the moment they see that, okay, the plane changes like this, everyone forget to think about the movie that they saw last night. Huh? Everyone forgot the pizza that had to be ordered after the lecture and after the class and all that. Everyone was curious how this happened. So that's the kind of advantage we have. That's the kind of advantage. No one has given this kind of flavor in 13, 14 years. That's the kind of advantage we have. So that's my answer to you. I don't mind. I can be here. This is what? This is 10. Oh, I cannot be. Okay.
Sir, in starting, as you said, like 0 to 3, 4 years, kids are they learn naturally, right? But sir, I have covered with that question. Then after that, like he comes or she comes in the 4th year, 5th year, and even the parents used to send the schools and they used to send to the tutor and something like that, it starts like that. people used to get in the same system. The main problem is that why this system happened and why this system have been created. So if we found the reason, like then only we can find the solution. But we have the problems and we are going to find the solution. That's it. We are not going to find the permanent solution. Like, okay, as you came today, everybody are listening to you, and after that, 1 or 2 days, everybody will forget. Then what should be the permanent solution? And same, if people used to go for peace to the temple, one day they will get the peace, oh, I got the peace in the temple. After the second day, what will happen? There's no permanent solution for that. So same for trafficking to peace.
All right, so maybe to explore that, please sit down. To explore that root reason, we have to go into history. In past, we had a very different kind of educational system. Past means, say, 500 years ago, 300 years ago. We had a very different kind of system where there was no central body to control. Parashuram has one school, Dronacharya has one school, Vasist has one school, Vishwamitra has one school. So the teacher, the educator, according to his or her own specialization, could develop a system. And one system could be very different from the other system, right? And then people are trained in specific skills and all that. Then even before the Britishers, we had literacy, 100% literacy in India before Britishers. Right, that was stated by Mohandas Karamchand Gandhi in that Goldsmith conference that you destroyed our education system. There was 100% literacy before you came. And then this British government, with one stroke of pen, they closed all the gurukuls, all the Sanskrit vidyalayas, all the madrasas. And they formulated some rules that the education has to be given according to these sects. Right? So to explore that root cause, one has to go back into history and see what kind of system we had before this Britishers, what kind of system we have. I won't say that we have to bring that back into this. Right? The 300 years the world has advanced. So we have to develop the system, not Vishwamitra system we can bring back. But yes, we must see what was the strength of that. And in the current scenario, what things should be incorporated, how it should be developed. So this needs perhaps this is a democracy, right? This is a democracy. Things are decided by parliament, and parliament is constructed by majority of voters, the general masses. So the general masses have to be educated that there is a need for such an overall, such a wholesale change, and they should put pressure on these lawmakers. That means you need a kind of an agitation, an andolan, educational agitation. Not going on the street, but training the minds, the general masses' minds. So all those things are there. But whatever is done, whatever changes are done, at the end, you need those mediators, which we call teachers. You need teachers. Whatever changes are made in the policy, if the teachers are not in the right mind frame, then it will not be implemented. So although it is not a permanent solution, there's a temporary solution or this and that, but we have to keep our shops open. We should not close our shops. So the teachers, I'm focusing on teachers. The teachers should be there with those innovative minds, with those mindsets, those thinking processes, so that whenever after 50 years or whenever there is a real change in the system, not this chapter coming to that class and this chapter going to that class, that time the society is ready to accept it. Right? So we have to keep doing such works. We have to keep enlightening our teachers and our students as well. On the parallel, the intellectuals should do this kind of mass education where we know that these are the real problems of our education system and has to be changed, it has to be amended, it has to be corrected, a new system has to be put in place This is a long, long, it could be a long, long goal, and it can take several decades, 50 years, 40 years, I don't know how much. But then, till then, our candles must be on. Our switches must be on.
They are not, they're learning actually by failing. They're trying a lot of things, experimenting, and then on what worked, what didn't work. Now the moment they are a little bit older, there's an image problem. What do the other kids think, and what do the parents think? Parents have image, kids have image. So as a result, we have become a society which is very averse to failure. Really averse to failure, which is what prevents anybody from exploring anything. So how would you, with your long experience, recommend that we can fight this fear of failure and encourage failure, which truly will lead to success?
Well, I don't know what would be the right answer. What I feel is, if teacher and the students can make a team for learning, if that central idea that teacher knows everything and the student knows nothing, student will know only that much with the teacher will teach. If that central idea is to be done away with, and if the teacher and the students start exploring together, at least certain amount of it, and 90%, 95% you do in traditional manner, but if a 5%, 10% things, if teacher and students, if they make up a team to explore something new, right, then the failure will be a collective failure of the teacher as well as failure of the student, and the success will be a collective success of the teacher and success of the student. So if this kind of things can be included in the system, where 5% time, because I don't want to confront the system. I know that the system is very cruel, but at the same time, I do not want to confront them, right? Otherwise, they will kill me. Okay, so I steal away 5% of time from that system, and in 5%, that 5% of time, or 10% of that time, or 7% of the time, I do my innovations. So in that innovations, if I say that let's do collect, I do not know what will happen. You do not know what will happen. Let's try to make it. Let's try to do it. And then if there is a failure, no problem. If there is success, there is no problem. All the good, all the well. So if this can be included in our system, that 5 to 10% is given for this kind of failure, success, perhaps the fear of failure can go away.
Thank you, sir. We are closing the question answer session due to a time constraint. Celebrating the success is a noble initiative to honor and congratulate the students of IITM who participated in various national and international competitions. I humbly request the speaker to felicitate the 5th Inter-IIT Tech Meet participants of Dashboard and Unmanned Aerial Vehicle Design Challenge. I request the participants to come to the stage in order of their names. First, for Dashboard, Minu Ashwant. Chinni Chaitanya. Shashi Varnan. Nikhil Krishna. Now for Unmanned Aerial Vehicle Design Challenge, Prashant. Aditya Vinod. Akriti Singh. Nikhil. Ashutosh. Thank you, sir. I now request respected Professor Markandeyilu to felicitate the speaker with a memento. Thank you, sir, for that insightful lecture. I'm sure that the audience gathered a lot of knowledge and inspiration from your talk. We express our gratitude to Dr. H.C. Verma for giving us this opportunity to have him with us today. Sir, it was indeed a pleasure hosting you here. We would also like to thank everyone for their overwhelming support. Thank you. And please do stay for 5 minutes until the speaker leaves the stage. Thank you. The respected professors may leave with the speaker.